administration also. I came as a I'm not representing any organization. I'm not representing any even the institute. I am representing myself, and I'm just talking about my own viewpoint regarding this. Second is that I don't have any hidden agenda. I have only agenda. I will make my agenda very clear. And second is that if administration also wanted to join this lecture, I don't mind to have a discussion about that also, because that is always my political position, because I am not generally talk something and to act something or even pretend to be a revolutionary. That kind of things I am never consume myself. So I will definitely in favor of a disagreement. That is because I also sometimes in this occasion will disagree with your protest also. So you also have the freedom to disagree with me. That is one of the things that I think that this is what is important in this particular institute, because one of the things that is I always miss in this institute is that there is no possibility to disagree, because the disagreement is generally conceived as something as against the institute. For instance, I am not against the institute because I am be part of the institute, but at the same time, be part of the institute, I also know that my space is in this institute, and what are the kinds of things that I am sharing with the institute, and also I have a disagreement with the institute. So these are some of the things I want to make it first clear. And second point is that this is also related to my how I am looking at your agitation. That is one of the thing. I find this is an important event in TISS actually. Why I am saying this is an important event is that we always talk about TISS culture, TISS tradition, etc. But I always against the tradition and culture, because this is what actually the Indian culture, Malayali culture and all this culture I always used to say here, but I always in favor of making new cultures actually, and for me this is a new culture, and this is a new culture of disagreement, a new culture of dissent actually. So this one, this is I want to make it very clear. And I am saying that I find that the repercussions and the effect of your agitation is already circulating in this campus. That is one of the important things. For example, a person like me who has no voice almost for so many years in this campus, or so many people like us who don't have any voice in this particular campus, at least you people give us the opportunity to express our voice in our life. That is a very important, and for me, in that way, I almost like that, I feel that I am liberated from certain things, and I think that that is very important for me as a individually. This is one point. And second is also, I want to make another point, is that this is, what I'm talking is about the, I'm not looking at this agitation as an isolated kind of an event. I'm also looking at this in the larger kind of politics that is happening in all over the country, sometimes all over the world, for instance, and also especially the what is happening to the student politics. And one of my curiosity is always also related to how what is happening to the student politics, because I am as an observer, as a person who is interested in the politics, I am looking at and all. And if you look at in that particular way, I find that this movement is something that is unprecedented in even many level. Why I am saying is, for example, especially I am looking at from the context of the some of the sloganeering and the some of the act of you. I think one thing I am very interested in this curiosity, because I am actually learning from this also. One of these is that a group of students who actually demand to continue their scholarship. A group of categories of people. One thing that is amazed me is the support of the that category people and non-scholarship people for this specific interest. That is really is an amazing thing for me, because my generation is something very experience a different kind of an experience of something related to this issue. Especially that is related to the issue of the caste question actually, because our generation is coming from the post-Mandal kind of a situation, And one of the important thing about the Mandal Commission report and its effect is that suddenly a space which we all believed to be very secular and believed to be free from the caste is came with a kind of a debate regarding the caste after the independence, in the sense that somewhere we thought that caste is something that is already we had it was a something a pre-modern that was the our belief about the caste. But after Mandal Commission report, the caste question became a very important debating point in the in Indian campus. And one of the effect of that debate is that, and unfortunate also, one level it is unfortunate, it also contributed to an unintended consequence also. One is that the boundary of the students was that time was very clear, in the sense that at one level there is a group of students who are be part in favor of the reservation, and another group who are against the reservation. And generally the crowd is also like that, because one level the group who are supporting the commission report is the who are the beneficiary who will be the beneficiaries of the Mandal Commission report, and who are against that is that who thought that they would lose some of the privileges that they have in the existing institutions and all. So that actually was the effect of the Mandal Commission report. But here I find a different kind of things. You can also share me after my presentation. The thing is that here a group of students who are not have the benefit of the reservation, or who will is not getting any benefit of the reservation, is also coming and supporting those students who are in favor of the reservation. I find this, I contrast it with the what is happened in the Mandal Commission report, and that is what I think. In that particular context, I'm thinking that how can I think about, or I am looking at this particular kind of a movement of history and movement of the movement, for example. This is what I'm trying it is. That is why I find that that is why I called this movement as I am trying to understand with the framework of the politics of obligation. I will tell me why I am calling it as a politic of obligation. I know that there are a lot of confusion regarding these concepts and all that I will discuss. So this is one of the things. And why, and also I have an observation regarding that. This is also my observation. Why this kind of things happen? Is it just happen because that a group of students who are in favor of the reservation from the non-reserved categories just came in? I am not looking at it's a kind of a just an event that is happening, in the sense that, for example, there are a lot of other things also contributed for this formulation of the politics. And one of this is some of these are very eventful. I'm not saying that these are causes. One of the things I find is the effect of the Rohit Vemula in the Indian campus. And this is why I am saying is that most probably I know that Rohit Vemula has not got the justice even now from the authorities, because you know that those people who are responsible for the Rohit Vemula's suicide is in the higher positions in the universities, and they are ministers, etc., etc. But in that level, yes, Rohit Vemula have not got the justice. But one thing is that Rohit Vemula also find, I think, is has a great impact over the Indian campus. That is what I observed, in the sense that, for example, this is not just happening. I think that Rohit Vemula's photo is here, not because when I has gone to many universities and campus in this particular period, one thing I noted is that those figures, for example, the kind of figures like, for example, Ambedkar, Periyar, or figures like Ayyangali, who remained only at the level of the periphery of the Indian thinking and Indian politics, it just came out from that kind of a space, and it became a part of a mainstream kind of a things now. In the sense that now, in even wherever I go, that I am telling that I am from Kerala, one of the things that students ask is that, oh, you know about Ayyangali, and this is one of the important questions that students ask. And I really wonder is because that You know that in Ayyangali was never got a sufficient space in the historiography of Kerala, actually. The Kerala historiography actually excluded the Ayyangali from as a major part of the history of Kerala. But the thing is that from that particular context, that in this there is a context in which people are talking, we have a memorial lecture on Ayyangali, is for me, it's a different thing for me. And so, like that, I am saying that Periyar, for example, Periyar is just confined to a regional figure as a Tamil Nadu Dravidian movement, but that is not the case now. So my point is that all these Rohit Vemmula and all these factors contributed for making this as a kind of a effect on us, in the sense that effect on us in the means that, for example, the way I am looking at caste, the way I am looking at the campus, the way my friends and my colleagues are looking at the campus is something that is completely changed after these events. Actually, in the sense that Rohit Vimala, in that way, I'm not saying that Rohit Vimala to be celebrated. No, that is not. I want to, sometimes tomorrow this will be interpreted that I actually wanted the people more to commit more suicide and all. No, that is not my point. The point is that Rohit Vimala has an ideological effect over all of us, and that is still continuing in the Indian campus and all. This is one of the important things. And also, like that, these figures are also is almost like marginalized in the history, is suddenly coming and is a kind of a mainstream figure. And this has affected the not only the politics of the students, it also affected the various politics. Like, for example, it has affected the left politics in India. It affected the various other feminist. For example, I can hear easily now that within an LGBT community, people started to talk about the caste. Like that, within the Dalit community, people started to talk about the LGBT community. And that is, for me, is a different kind of politics that is happening. That we never anticipated earlier in our student period. In the sense, for us, we thought that these are all different identities and these are different kind of issues. And there is no possibility for these people to come together and talk to each other and fight for each other and to support each other. That I never expected. But it's very interestingly that kind of things are happening, and in that particular observation, I am looking at this as a kind of a political, as a kind of an politics of obligation. Why I am saying that, I know that because one of the things that you are all is against this idea of, for example, see, I know that when I'm talking about or using the word obligation, it looks like very feudal, in the sense that I have a obligation, because this is what Gandhi told, that okay, you are upper caste as an obligation to the lower caste. But my point here is not that. Actually, my point is that the obligation from the upper caste, or obligation from us, or obligation from the privileged group, is not coming because of the privilege. But the privileged group is forced to oblige to certain things, in the sense that there is a kind of force coming from this kind of movements, and this kind of movements forced the privileged group to react to that kind of a demand and to join with the marginalized communities in the country, in the sense that the privileged groups are now forced to be part of the marginalized, to be part of the marginalized group and fighting against the marginalization. This is what I called it as an obligation. The obligation is not that I have a privilege, so I am obliged to. It is not like that. It is a kind of a things that the whole demand is actually coming from the marginalization and the lower caste and other kind of unprivileged group that forced the others to come and give the support. And otherwise, I can't understand what is this kind of alliances that is happening. The thing is that, one way of looking at is, for example, that we are fighting because they have a right. Because this is one of the typical liberalist kind of argument always comes, in the sense that, okay, we are fighting because the lower caste and other caste has a right, so we are fighting for. I agree, in the sense that one of the important aspect of this fight is definitely related to the realization that the overcast has a right. But I don't think that it ends there, because if ends there, the immediate question is that then always that only then those group who actually have the particular right should come and fight, and it is the states and authorities' responsibility to respond to that. There is no need of the others to fight for the less privileged. There is, because in right discourse there is no need for the privileged group is fighting for the right for the less privileged group. So what is that? That is what I'm saying, that even though there is a very strong element of the right discourses, but I think that is not sufficient enough to look at this kind of this one of the moment. That is one of the my observation regarding this. Because for instance, I am saying is that, see, you are all talking about one thing is that we are against the privatization. And we are against the privatization. I agree with the larger idea of the against the privatization. But I am, and at the same time, I also want to make another point is that doesn't mean that the things are very good before the privatization. We should not talk like, in the sense that this public institute also is always, as it is not equally accessible to the all sections of the population in India. It never was the case even in the public, when these institutions were in the public. In the sense that always there was a kind of discriminations existed in this kind of institutions before the privatization also. So because of that, I am not confined this question of this fight, your fight against this thing is the fight against the privatization. Definitely the question of the privatization is very important, because the thing is that you cannot raise this kind of issue like a university like Ashoka or Jindal or other kind of private universities. You cannot even think about it. At least you can actually raise this issue here because of this possibility of this idea of public institution is remaining. This is one of the things I want to emphasize. And second, also I want to say is that, for example, what is this kind of relationship existing between the students from cutting across caste, class? I'm not saying that there is no, because even I would even say in the classroom that I can easily say that the caste, for example, somebody told that the word classroom is a very interesting word, in the sense that in the European context, classroom means actually the classroom, because the class is almost reproducing here. And also, for example, if you look at that, I would definitely say that gender and even the caste is reproducing in the classroom. In that, so I am not saying that kind of inequality is not existing there. But at the same time, I also want to look at that. There is also, where is this possibility of the alliances, and where is that possibility of the supporting each other kind of things would also be emerged. So in that way, I am not very cynical that people are casteist, people are classist, or people are patriarchal. I would never argue like the sense that always one of my hope from you generation is that you generation have the energy to break some of these barriers, one of the important formula that Ambedkar makes is the annihilation of the caste. I know that most probably our generation failed to take that kind of an ideology, but you generation have that possibility of taking as a kind of a discourse to that this question of the annihilation of the caste and all. So if that is so, I definitely look at this with a lot of hope, and lot of hope of that. It is not a kind of a hope that, okay, you upper caste people come and support you. That is not the case, in the sense that it is actually, you are actually is making a history in this particular context. This is another point also. So one point I want to talk one point here in the last context. This also been sometimes is discussed as a kind of an appropriation. And I'm sure that appropriation question is a very important kind of a question, because in various contexts we know, because when we were as a students, one of the things that we always faced is that whenever there was a student movement, one of the organized movement finally hijacked the whole thing, and finally people like me, who is always taking an independent stance, completely is excluded from the whole process. But the thing is that, so I always believe that there is always a possibility of the appropriation, but I also suggest is to don't stop your discussion about this kind of question by just have an allegation that this is an appropriation, because we want to move away from this kind of a discourses, because we are all fed up it at one particular context is that we cannot talk each other on the basis of ideologies. I'm not saying that we have to discard the ideologies, but my point is there any possibility to have a dialogue between different ideologies and different politics? This is one of the things that we want to think about it, and I think that is happening at least very momentarily at this moment in this campus, and I in that way I am very happy that this actually is creating a new kind of a politics in the campus. This is another thing I wanted to tell that, and what I'm saying is that, for example, that I very strongly believe in the politics of obligation. Why I am saying is for political obligation, from my own experience, then I will stop this thing and we can have a discussion. I and Bindu Casey and one of my other colleague was dismissed from the Tuljapur campus, and when we were dismissed, we were moving around the legal system to fight against the institute. We approached the lawyers, and then we realized one thing is that they all told that don't think that you can fight with the Tata Institute, because Tata Institute is a big institution, which is the only thing what you lose is that you will just lose the money and all. So we all at one level lost the hope. Actually, we thought that there is no possibility to fight with this system. That is all. But very interestingly, one thing that happened, I still have a very, that is why I sometimes I don't know, if you ask me, you just explain what is obligation, I don't know. But the thing is that sometimes that is very important for me, that suddenly a group of students started to campaign for us, actually, in the sense that they asked the authorities to reinstate us. And it has gone to a different level. Actually, we always thought that why these students is fighting for us, in the sense that what we are just doing is the normal thing, like that, for example, that we are as a teachers is used to do in the classroom. And some of the times, most of our classes are very boring, and it's all happening, and the students are bored in the classes and all this. But finally, these students are fighting for us. Why? So I always ask this question, why these students are fighting for us? And we don't have that kind of a contract. And we don't have that kind of a relationship outside. So that is what I find, that there is some kind of unnameable, there is something called a non-definable kind of relationship also existing between the individuals and the groups. So my point is that movement, I realized that there are certain things that also is working apart from the liberal idea of the political kind of the demanding for the political right, etc., etc. So if that, in that particular context, I think that we need to think about the politics we have to think about the politics which broadly within, not confined to the liberal kind of a discourse. And I'm not saying that you have to discard the idea of the liberalism completely, but there are certain things that is what is happening in our politics is outside the realm of the liberal politics. So we have, so what I'm trying to do is that, from my own experience and my own observation about the movement and observation of this the students' movement here and observation of other movements there, I also trying to understand this movement. I'm not saying that I am, my theory or my understanding is a perfect. You can actually question me, and I'm welcome for that, you are questioning. But at the same time, I also want to know more about from this, that is there anything kind of things, that kind of relationship is happening? Because finally what matters for me is that kind of a relationship. If this politics is actually creating a different kind of human relationship here, and I think that is the most important thing that I would be very happy. And I think that is happening, and that is the hope from this moment.
Can we... before question answers, I think they are waiting. So, kya allow karte hai ya fir question answers ke baat karein?
Allow
karein. Okay. So, Kaka? Mohan Kaka?